Hello viewers, welcome to UN Digital Class. In today's lecture, I am going to discuss about Secure Socket Layer, that is SSL. Now, let us start. First of all, we will discuss about the SSL architecture. Here, SSL is designed to provide security and compression service to data generated from the application layer. That means the SSL provides the security on the data which is received from the application layer, and it also provides the compression function on that data. Next, SSL can receive data from any application layer protocol, but usually the protocol is HTTP. That means when the SSL receives the data from the application layer, it uses a protocol that is called as the HTTP protocol, which is Hypertext Transfer Protocol. Next, the data received from the application layer is compressed, signed, and encrypted, which means when the SSL layer receives the data from the application layer, that data must be compressed, signed, and encrypted. Next, the data is then passed to a reliable transport layer protocol such as TCP, which means here the SSL layer receives the data from the application layer, then it transmits that data to the transport layer by using a protocol that is called the TCP protocol. Next, Netscape developed the SSL in 1994. Then next one is version 2 and version 3 were released in 1995. Then next, services of the SSL. Here, SSL provides several services on data received from the application layer. Now look at the first service. Here the first service is fragmentation. That means first SSL divides the data into blocks of 2 to the power 14 bytes or less, which means when the SSL receives the data from the application layer, first of all it divides the data into blocks, and each block size is 2 to the power 14 bytes or less. This is the service which is called as fragmentation. Now, look into the next service, that is compression. Here, each fragment of data is compressed using one of the lossless compression methods negotiated between the client and the server. That means after fragmentation, then the SSL provides the compression function to compress the data which is received from the application layer. Here the compression function which is used for compressing the data, that compression function must be negotiated between the client and server. And this compression is nothing, it is the optional part. Next, message integrity. To preserve the integrity of data, SSL uses a key hash function to create a map. That means here, message integrity means it is nothing but if there is any modification during the transmission of data from the application layer to transport layer, then that modification must be detected. That is called as the message integrity service. Here the SSL provides this message integrity service by using a keyed hash function to create a MAC, that is the message authentication code. Next service is confidentiality. To provide confidentiality, the original data and the MAC are encrypted using symmetric key cryptography. That means when a data is transmitted from the application layer to the transport layer, then that data must be confidential or it maintains the privacy. For providing confidentiality, the SSL provides the encryption to the Mac and the data by using some symmetric key cryptography. Then next service is farming. Here a header is added to the encrypted payload and the payload is then passed to a reliable transport layer. That means after providing the confidentiality service, then a header is added to the payload. After adding the header to the payload, then the data is transmitted to the transport layer. These are the different services which are provided by the SSL layer when data is transmitted from the application layer to the transport layer. Then next, key exchange algorithms. Now look at this figure. This figure shows the different key exchange algorithms. Here the first algorithm is null. Then next one is the RSA algorithm, which is basically used for the encryption. Then next one is the anonymous Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm. Then next, ephemeral Diffie-Hellman, that is the RSS or DSS, which means DSS is nothing but that is the digital signature. Then next, fixed Diffie-Hellman. Then last one is the Frateja. Now I am going to discuss each algorithm of key exchange one by one. First of all, we will discuss about the null. Now look at the null key exchange algorithm. In this algorithm, there is no key exchange between the client and server. And also, there is no pre-master secret established between the client and server. That means, in this algorithm, there is no pre-master secret and there is no key exchange algorithm between the client and server. But both client and server need to know the value of the pre-master secret so that they can exchange the information between them. Now look at the next key exchange algorithm, that is the RSA algorithm. In this method, the pre-master secret is a 48-byte random number created by the client and encrypted by the server's RSA public key and sent to the server. That means in RSA, here the pre-master secret is nothing but it is a random number of size 48-byte. And this random number is encrypted by using the public key or by using the RSA public key of the server. Then after encrypting this pre-master secret value, then the client send it to the server. Here this random number or this pre-master secret is encrypted by using the public key of the server so that when the server receives this encrypted value, then the server uses its own private key and decrypt the value. Then next, the server needs to send its RSA encryption decryption certificate, which means after receiving the pre-master secret value, then the server sends its encryption and decryption certificate to the client. Now look at the figure. In this figure, the client generates a 48-bit random number which is called a pre-master secret. After generating this pre-master secret value, then the client encrypts this value by using the public key of the server. After encrypting, then the client sends this encrypted value to the server. Here this encrypted value is S. When the server receives this encrypted value, then the server uses its own private key and decrypt the value and get the original pre-master secret value. This is the RSA key exchange algorithm process. Then next, anonymous Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm. This is the simplest and most insecure method. Here, the pre-master secret is established between the client and server using the Diffie-Hellman protocol. And here, the Diffie-Hellman hub keys are sent in plain text. So, it is called anonymous Diffie-Hellman. Because neither party is known to other. And the disadvantage of this key exchange algorithm is man in the middle attack. Because in anonymous Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm, here the half key is attached with the plain text. And in this case, the both party, that means the client and the server, they don't know to each other. For this reason, this is called a anonymous Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm. And in this algorithm, the main disadvantage is the man in the middle attack. That means when a message is transmitted from the client to the server by using the anonymous Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm, in this case the half key is attached with the plain text so that the third party can easily get that plain text from the network and get the key. This is called the man in the middle attack, and this is the main disadvantage of the anonymous Diffie-Hellman key exchange. Now look at this figure. In this figure, the server sends the Diffie-Hellman parameter, that is G and P, and the half Diffie-Hellman key, that is the G to the power S, to the client. After receiving all these parameters, then the client send the parameter which is received from the server, that is GP, and it also generates G to the power C, that is sent to the server. Here the pre-master secret is G to the power CS mod P, and by using this pre-master secret the client and server start communication. But here G to the power S and G to the power C, these two are transmitted over the network without using any encryption algorithm. For this reason, when these parameters are transmitted over the network, there is some middleman which can take these parameters and generate the pre-master secret. For this reason, this anonymous Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm is an insecure algorithm. Next one is the ephemeral Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm. Here, to thwart the man in the middle attack, the ephemeral Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm can be used. That means, to avoid the man in the middle attack in the anonymous Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm, this ephemeral Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm is used. Here, each party sends a Diffie-Hellman key signed by its private key, which means when the client sends its Diffie-Hellman key, it must sign this key by using its own private key. Similarly, when the server sends its key to the client, then the server must sign that key by using its own private key, then it's sent to the client. Then next, the receiving party needs to verify the signature using the public key of the sender. That means, suppose the server sends its key by encrypting it with its own private key, then send it to the client. When the client receives this key from the server, then the client must use the server's public key and decrypt that value. Then the public key for verification are exchanged using either RSA or DSS digital signature certificate, which means when the key is signed by each party's private key, then that value must be decrypted by using their public key. For this reason, the public key must be exchanged between the client and server. When the public key is exchanged between the client and server, then that exchange must be in a secure way. And for exchanging this public key, here the RSA algorithm or DSS digital signature algorithm is basically used. Now, look at this figure. In this figure, when the server sends its key to the client, first of all, the server must sign its key with its own private key. Sorry, here the SIG, that is the signature S, which means sign with the server private key, not the server public key. That means in the step 1, when the server sends its key, that is the G, P and G to the power S, these parameters must be signed with its own private key, that is the server private key. Similarly, when the client sends its signature to the server, that is the step 2. That means here the G, P and G to the power C, these parameters are signed by using the client's private key. But here, that is sign G, C, which is signed with client private key, not public key. After signing the key value by using their own private key, then it sent to the other party. That means when the server signed its key with its own private key, after that it sent this value to the client, then the client similarly generates its key and sign it with own private key and send it to the server. After that, the pre-master secret is generated, which is G to the power CS. Now, this pre-master secret is confidential because here G to the power S is encrypted by using the server's private key and G to the power C is encrypted by using the client private key. If there is some middleman which want to retrieve this value, then that middleman must know the public key of the client and the public key of the server. For this reason, when the server and client exchange their public key, they must use the encryption algorithm, that is the RSS algorithm or DSS algorithm, so that they can securely exchange their public key. And these public keys are basically required for the decryption. This is all about the ephemeral Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm. And this algorithm provides the advantages, that is, there is no middleman attack because of the encryption. Next, fixed Diffie-Hellman. Here, another solution of the key exchange is fixed Diffie-Hellman method. Here all entities in a group can be prepared a fixed Diffie-Hellman parameter, that is G and P. Then last one is the protégé. Here the protégé key exchange algorithm is a registered trademark of the USA National Security Agency, that is NASA. It is a family of security protocols developed for the Defense Department. These are the different key exchange algorithm which is basically used by the SSL to provide the authentication and the confidentiality when the data is transmitted from the application layer to the transport layer. Next, encryption algorithms. Now, look at this figure. This figure shows the different encryption algorithms which are used in SSL. First one is the null, second stream RC4, then next one is the block RC2, then next block DS, then next one is the block IDEA, then last one is the block FORTEJA. These are the different encryption algorithms which is used by the SSL to provide the security when the data is transmitted from the application layer to the transport layer. First of all, null. Here the null category simply defines the lack of an encryption decryption algorithm. That means If there is no encryption and decryption algorithm is used when the data is transmitted from the application layer to transport layer, that is called the null. The next one is the stream RC. That means here two RC algorithms are defined in stream mode. The next one is the block RC, which means one RC algorithm is defined in the block mode. Which means here you must remember that in stream RC encryption, two RC algorithms is used in block mode, and block RC means one RC algorithm is defined in block mode. Next one is the DES, that is all DES algorithms are defined in block mode. The next IDEA. Here the IDEA algorithm defined in block mode is IDEA CPC with a 128 bit key. Then next encryption algorithm is Proteja. The one Proteja algorithm defined in block mode is Proteja CBC. These are the different encryption algorithms. Then next, hash algorithms. Here in hash algorithms, first one is the null, second one is the MD5, then last one is the SHA-1. And basically this hash algorithm is used by the SSLR to provide the authentication when the data is transmitted from the application layer to the transport layer. First one is the null. Here the two parties may decline to use an algorithm. In this case there is no hash function and the message is not authenticated. That means in this case the two parties are declined to use any hash algorithm for message authentication or confidentiality. That is the case of null. Then next, MD5. Here the two parties may choose MD5 as the hash algorithm. In this case a 128 bit key MD5 hash algorithm is used. That means in MD5 hash algorithm, here both parties, that is the client and server, are decided to use this MD5 algorithm for message authentication. And here this MD5 is 128 bit key MD5. Then next one is the SHA-1. Here the two parties may choose SHA as the hash algorithm. And in this case a 160 bit SHA-1 hash algorithm is used. That means in this case the two parties are agreed to use the SHA hash algorithm for message authentication. And particularly in this case 160 bit SHA-1 algorithm is used for message authentication. These are the different hash algorithm which is used by the SSL to provide the message authentication when the message is transmitted from the application layer to the transport layer. This is all about the secure socket layer. Basically, here you must remember that the secure socket layer is basically used to provide the security when the data is transmitted from the application layer to the transport layer. And for providing the security, the SSL uses different key exchange algorithm and the different encryption algorithm and the different hash algorithm. If you have any doubt regarding this secure socket layer, then you can ask me through comment. I will discuss about your doubt. Thank you for watching.